Your signal. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the second meeting of the Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2023. Since last we met, we sadly have lost the services of Paul Sweeney, MSP, who's been with the committee since the formation of the Parliament. And I just want to place on record my thanks to Paul. He was a very proactive member of the committee, and I very much enjoyed his insights and sometimes, well, I suppose he wouldn't mind me saying out of left field thinking in response to some of the petitions that we were considering. But in his place, I'm absolutely delighted to welcome Carol Mockin to the committee. Carol has been with us before in a substitute capacity, but now joins us as a full member of the committee. And although she did in that capacity make a declaration of interest, just for completeness sake, I think probably for the record as well, to invite Carol to do that this morning.
Thank you, Convener. It's good to join the committee, and I'll pass on your best wishes to Paul. And I have nothing to declare at this time. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And that brings us to item two, which is simply for members to confirm that we're content to take item five in private. Are members content for us so to do? We are. That brings us to item three this morning, which is the consideration of continued petitions. And we have two continued petitions this morning in which we intend to hear some evidence. The first of those is petition number 1941 to stop the destruction of headstones within community cemeteries, which was lodged by Councillor Andrew Stewart Wood. The petition calls on Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to monitor and regulate actions taken by local authorities when undertaking the statutory duty of ensuring health and safety within our cemeteries. Now, we are joined this morning by the petitioner, Councillor Andrew Stewart Wood, and Desmond Barr from the Friends of Hawkhead Cemetery. Good morning to you both. Thank you for coming to give us evidence on this petition this morning. And in addition to that, we are joined by Paul O'Kane, MSP, who will be sharing any comments and reflections once we've heard from our witnesses. Now, members have a number of questions they would like to explore. Is there anything either of you would like to just say in advance of us kicking that off, or are you happy for us just to move to questions?
If I can, first of all, thank you very much for allowing this petition to come through and for you to hear it. Now, I have photographs in my possession, if you would like me to share those with you, so that you can get a flavour of what has been happening. So if that's acceptable through yourself, Chair.
Yes. Through, are these in hard copy or digital?
Look at my age.
In which case, I'm assuming that's to suggest that they're in hard copy, but I don't like to presume. But no, if through right. The clerks you'd like to, yes, that would be very helpful. We had a recent inquiry into natural woodlands, and actually photographs were very helpful to the committee in understanding the issue. Although, sadly, from time to time, all of us have had to visit cemeteries, and I think are kind of, in our own experience, aware of some of the issues. Can I ask just a kind of question to try and set this in context? Because, as I say, probably we have all, in the last few years, had occasion to visit a cemetery, and not necessarily one with which we would be familiar, although I am familiar with the cemetery about which you are, with which you are concerned. And I suppose the kind of natural question that occurred to me just on my own account visiting is this, has this started to happen recently? Presumably, in a historical context, the maintenance of cemeteries, graveyards, will always have been an issue that had to be handled and progressed. And is it that the kind of golden age, if you like, of more sort of established upright headstones was at a point where all of the infrastructure of those types of headstones is now showing its age in terms of whether it's sinking or whether it's falling? What has happened, do you think, in a kind of context situation to make this a much more a greater issue of public concern now than maybe it has been?
I think this has been brought to our attention and it's a knee-jerk reaction from the unfortunate death of a young lad in Glasgow. And then the Scottish Government put forward the guidance on health and safety within the graveyards. Councils found themselves... basically, their budgets are squeezed that tight that they want to do it the most cost-effective way and long-term, you know, work that will see them with as little cost being incurred. And in doing so, they certainly, Dumfries and Galloway, initially did not follow the guidance, and it's very good guidance that the Scottish Government has put forward, but they did not follow it. And that's why we find ourselves where we are. Now, it's been ongoing for some 18 months, and I put a motion forward to Dumfries and Galloway Council at one of their full councils, and we got a respite where they went back to look at what they were doing right and what they were doing wrong. They took on board everything I said about the guidance that was set out, and they have made some improvements. However, as I say, it's 18 months and they're now talking about going back to resume work as they were doing before. Clearly states within your own guidance that every headstone should be treated individually, should have its own file, and to date that's not happened. We are concerned about the contractor that is undertaking this work and about the actual training and certification of competence in doing and carrying out that work, because my sources tell me that it's in-house and it is not a national recognised accreditation that they've got. So that's just kind of gives you...
But it still doesn't really... It doesn't explain to me why all this is suddenly... I mean, how... what? How were these stones and layers kind of maintained historically? I mean, what has changed? Is it that families have simply run out of the line, or is it that people now are much more transient and have moved away and that there's nobody left who can, you know, accept a responsibility for these things? Is it that families have inherited what now is quite a costly exercise to consider undertaking in terms of the maintenance of headstones? You know, what has made it... I mean, I understand the fatality, you know, that took place, but was that the first time that had happened? I mean, had headstones not been toppling over before that, or was it the fact there was a fatality that brought it forward as something of considerable public concern that led the government to come forward with those regulations?
Yes, it's exactly that the government basically brought forward this guidance and they wanted actions taken by local authorities. That's what happened. Now, to date... all those owners of layers, they assumed that their headstones were in fit order. They saw no reason to doubt the quality of the structure. And a lot of the headstones that have been dismantled for no just cause, because modern headstones actually have, I think it's 9-inch pins that go from the base up into the headstone. There's no way that can fall over, and that comes from a recognised undertaker. That yes, they will become...
These are steel rods or something.
These are steel rods. This is the other part as well, is that they removed the headstone and left the steel rods sticking up. Now, this is supposed to be health and safety. I brought that to the attention of the council. They then went along and cut the steel rods off, which now means if somebody wants to... put that headstone back correctly, it's going to be additional cost. If the council had been smart, they would have assessed the cost of actually doing the maintenance on the headstone, and they would have found it would have been very little additional cost just to put it correct, to lift the headstone off and to re-putty it or use the sealant that's required to... secure it and stop it wobbling. So,
what in your view should be the main consideration for a local authority when it comes to taking into account whether or not memorials are safe? What should be the criteria that they set that standard to?
it should be exactly as your guidance sets out, that it should be a professional person that undertakes the test right from the word go. They should then, if there is identified a flaw or a fault, it should then be brought to the attention of the lair owner if they can find that lair owner, because as you rightly pointed out at the very beginning, some are no longer in line. So that's what they should do. They could also have consulted with the community councils who know a lot of the families within their own area. They could have contacted the elected members, and they never bothered to do that either.
And I mean, sorry, this, forgive me, I just don't know a lot about the...
Yes.
I don't know, something I've done. So is there therefore a kind of routine test done, an inspection done where...
Yes. I don't know what the routine is, in fairness, but yes, there are...
Right.
You know...
So it's not by exception, it's that a cemetery would be assessed by somebody who would be going yes. round and who would identify. Now, in some cases, it seems on a completely blanket basis, they've just knocked all the headstones yeah. over flat. But it should be that on a kind of a bespoke basis, they establish what's necessary in right. relation to any particular plot.
Yes, you're absolutely correct.
OK. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. Councils have various ways of dealing with unsafe memorials. What would you like to see as good practice from the councils?
What I would like to see is proper auditing. I would like an independent auditor to go through local authorities and check that they have followed the guidance set out by yourselves. I would also like to have proper monitoring of the policies that every local authority has. And furthermore, due to the damage that has taken place to date, I would ask for the restoration of all works done to date, because guidance has clearly not been followed. They have actually breached a B-listed cemetery by going into it without having the permission from the planning department, their own planning department. I find that totally unacceptable.
It occurs to me that as well, maybe Desmond Barr would like to come in yes. on these. I hadn't apologies for not bringing you in sooner, but no, please just flag up at any time if you want to contribute.
Thanks very much, Convener. And can I also thank the committee for allowing us to be here today and to speak on this subject. The overall view that Renfrewshire Council have is very much in line with the guidelines that were produced. They were produced in the first instance at the request of, or not the request, the recommendation, sorry, of the sheriff who held the fatal accident inquiry. And that was one of our recommendations, that the Scottish Government should bring forward guidelines, as Andrew has said. And Renfrewshire Council put a lot of consideration into what would actually happen, how they would monitor the situation with regards to headstones. So they put in a 5-year rolling programme, and that to this day is continuing. It started 2020. We obviously came into the pandemic, and that was suspended. But they then started the programme again, probably just about 18 months ago, in a smaller scale, and that has now rolled fairly rapidly around all 9 cemeteries, not just Hawkhead Cemetery, but the 9 cemeteries that Renfrewshire Council are responsible for, and other burial grounds as well. Our biggest concern, and I think it's about the anxiety, the anguish, the distress, there's so many adjectives that people have used to describe that. To me, it is most distressing for people to turn up to visit a grave and see the headstone lying flat. And the number of people who just can't believe that this has happened to their member of a family, and they've not had any communication from the council directly. Yes, there are signs placed within the cemetery. None of them have been permanent. They're A-boards that the council tend to move around. There are a couple of them that are at the entrance to the cemetery, but anybody that knows Hawkhead if you're driving in, you've got to drive in immediately and go past everything because, you know, it's a busy road. So the communication is something that I think definitely should be considered. When the work has been completed, they stake the grave. One, it's an advisory notice to say that the headstone has been had this work carried out on it to review the safety, and where they have dropped the headstone, then they put a second advisory notice to say that this had to come down because it was unsafe. One of the things that we would like is that there would be a first advisory notice, which was a stake in the ground at the headstone saying that this is going to be subject to review in the next, say, 6 weeks, which gave people the opportunity then to get in touch with the council or to get in touch with their own stone memorial mason and see whether or not there was any work that was required done rather than it be dropped and then have this distress.
David Torrance.
Thank you for that. Just on the point about communication there, surely there must be records of who has the plots that the council could contact, I'm sure.
In their own recommendation to the policy board, they state clearly that they are not able to contact the current layer holder. I could probably accept that in terms of going back. The cemetery opened in 1891, and we would accept that nobody will now be available. Not nobody, sorry. That in most cases there would be no record holder. But the modern day records are there. Renshire Council should be praised for the fact that you know they do maintain them, but not to use them is, I think, the biggest concern. I mean, you know, if somebody has a parent who has maybe died when they have been young and they're now in their 60s or 70s, we accept that layer will be, 70 years old. But for somebody who is looking, you know, we've got cases where people have came to us and the layer's only 12 years old. Now, you know, clearly, as Andrew's saying, that work wasn't completed properly, and we have again written to the council asking them more about prevention, whether or not trading standards are monitoring new headstones, are they monitoring the work that's been done, because obviously people now are encountering quite a bit of cost, anything round about 600 upwards for you know headstones okay. to be put up.
I think Councillor Wood wants just back in.
It was really just to say that on records with regards to headstone and ownership, a lot of that can be found from undertakers and stonemasons. The councils also have records as well. So it's not as though there's a lack of record. Yes, there will be some that, for example, going back to 18th, 19th century stones, clearly it's difficult then to get the records. But what I would also say, and pick up on what Desmond's saying about communication, there were two headstones within the Sankar graveyard whereby they were the graves of the veterans. Now, they've actually gone and restored those because that you're not supposed to have touched or damaged them in any shape or form. However, the council never even bothered to contact the Commonwealth War Grave Commission on that. So that was another failing on their part. Mm-hmm. I also want to emphasise that this is not just purely about Sankar graveyard that I'm here, because since I started this issue, I have been contacted by various people across Scotland. Mm. I have heard about, I think it was either Orkney or Shetland, where the same destruction took place. However, the council quite rightly has restored the damage being done. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the photos that went round, it's the photocopy one, shows Peebles. There was a chap from Peebles contacted me with regard to that graveyard where all these headstones were made out of sandstone. And as most of you will know, if sandstone is left lying on the ground with water sitting in all the inscribing, and frost, it blows the inscribing, it just defaces everything.
No, I mean, I think, and I think the committee considered having COSLA with us this morning, but I think we probably will be asking them to respond to some of the issues that arise from this. David Torrance?
The practice of laying headstones down flat or digging their trenches has been heavily criticised. Is it feasible to ban or restrict these practices?
Sorry, I missed that.
The practice of laying, you know, headstones down flat or digging their trenches around them. Is it feasible to ban or restrict the practices of doing this?
Yes, I see no reason why that if there was a policy, one of the it could be an alteration to the Scottish Government's own guidance. They could state quite clearly that they do not want to see headstones destroyed in any manner. You know?
But, I mean, I suppose you do have the issue where there could be a dangerous headstone. And obviously, I suppose, depending on the complexity or style that you know of the particular memorial, that could be both dangerous but also a very costly undertaking and not necessarily something the council will immediately think it can accommodate.
Can I let Desmond in? I'll come in after Desmond.
Mr. Barr,
convener, the situation that you know this all results from in terms of the death within Creighton Cemetery involved a headstone that was just under 7 feet tall and weighed 2.5 ton. I'm not talking about the normal headstone that you know you would see in general in a more modern cemetery, except within Hawkhead Cemetery. There are some larger, very heavy stones, memorials, I think, that they would probably be considered as opposed to a headstone. And Renfrewshire Council do have a policy, a separate policy as such, a separate contractor, sorry, rather than a policy for dealing with them. That hasn't been undertaken as yet, but the idea that headstones that are 2 foot high have been knocked down, that is the one.
So, in part, if I can cut it, your concern is that a policy that was established as a consequence of a fatality, mm-hmm. where a headstone memorial of some 7 feet and of heavy construction led to the death of an individual, led to regulations which are being applied now to much smaller and frankly less dangerous headstones, but in a highly destructive way, which is without notice in causing both distress but sometimes irreparable damage to the stone itself. Okay, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Camilla. Thank you, gentlemen. I think you make some very valid points when it comes to where we are and how we got to this situation, because it was primarily health and safety that may have created the situation scenario. And there are some guidelines and there are some standards. But I think, you know, what are your views on being the Scottish Government making a national standard that could be introduced to ensure that there are processes and there are communication to individuals who have memorials or the families of, to ensure that that standard would be met? And that could be created, as I say here, by the Scottish Government, because as you've explained, standards have been put in place for a type of headstone which is then being imparted on something very different. So if there were that national standard that was being used, would that be of benefit to try and make and resolve some of these situations?
Yes, I would say that would be a great assistance to where we are at present. But what I would also say, and this comes back to what the convener was talking about, and that is the restoration of dangerous headstones. The council also gets faced with dangerous buildings. Mm. And we have a statutory obligation to ensure that they are safe. The same should be applied to large memorials. I have a large memorial within my ward. It's Grierson of the Lags memorial. I have been on to the council to repair that. Now, I would classify that as extremely dangerous. And yet they've gone ahead and they've taken down gravestones, which may not be much more than 10 years old.
And I think that's the issue that we have here.
Yes.
Is that there are historical headstones that have stayed there for generations.
Yes.
And that there has been very little movement in any shape, way or form. There are now more modern ones that are much more at risk. And they are the target, or have been the target, by the situation for them to be knocked down or put in a situation. And that in itself becomes the problem.
I would also like to add to that, though. I think there's a commercial issue here as well.
Okay.
If you have a contractor that goes into a graveyard and they're going to get paid per headstone, what do you think that contractor might do? I'll leave that in your hands.
So I go back to my original question, Convener, about having some kind of national standard that could be introduced here by the Scottish Government to try and then placate some of that working praxis that takes place. And as you've identified, it's not just within your own council either. It's taken place across a number of locations and a number of graveyards and during a number of times that this takes place.
Yes, I would totally agree with that. I don't know what Desmond's position on that is, but I would totally agree with that. However, what I would say is that I would ask for a halt on all works to date, and that as an interim, they would go on to just staking any headstone that might appear to be unsafe.
Mr. Bard, do you want to?
Well, I'm looking at the printed out a summary of the replies from the local authorities that you had posted on the motion. And there are a number of local authorities who do not lay flat. And there are also, I think there's two authorities who, just as Andrew just said there, have suspended all works because of the distress.
Yeah.
Which, you know, possibly after 2 years, we've maybe looked at the ones which are going to have caused the most danger. So in terms of Renshire Council's policy, they've looked at the bigger headstones, which in the event of them falling may very well have caused a danger. And it's not for anybody, I don't think, to say, oh, we'll not classify that as a danger. But I think that to apply some sort of reason. So exactly what you're saying there, we would endorse that, but certainly the suspension of the scheme until such times as this committee or the parliament had a chance to review the guidance, because I think it's I think 2 years down the line, I mean, I don't think anybody ever really realised what was going to come over and the distress that it would cause.
Thank you, Convener.
And thank you for the photo. I mean, the photographs you've given us show an example of one headstone where it's literally been halved, and this one half's been, and a very good example of the trenching, where essentially a hole has been dug, the stone has then been inserted in the hole, and really all the detail on the stone of the more recently bereaved is buried now beneath the ground, and along with, unfortunately, the bereaved, so that you've got no idea any longer who the stone is actually commemorating. It does look quite crass when you see it. Mr. Ewing, Carol Mockin, have either of you got any questions you would like to ask? Carol Mockin.
I'm just interested to know if, you have sort of specific recommendations from across the groups that you've spoken to. Is there two or three specific points that everybody agrees would be helpful?
I think in the first instance, communication. For somebody to turn up and the headstone to be laid flat, with, you know, we accept that there are signs up, but, you know, it's like everything in life, you think, well, that really applies to somebody else, that not be ours, because we're there every week or every month and we see it standing. And we do accept that some of the headstones may in actual fact be cause for concern, and that there is a very necessary reason for the health and safety policy being there. I don't think we want to kind of kid on that there aren't issues, but I think that prevention is probably the biggest thing. And in regards to communication, if we do utilise the records that we do have, then that, I think, is important, especially when they are up to date, or we invite people to ensure that their records are as accurate as possible. Thanks.
One of the considerations that a constituent of mine put forward was, why is it that when we have headstones erected that there's not a maintenance plan put on that headstone, that the family would continue to contribute a set amount for that maintenance? Another one that was suggested is you could take out insurance on your headstones so that you paid up an insurance that if it had to get repaired, the insurer would pick up the tab. So there are lots of options out there.
Lovely. Thanks, Convener.
OK, thank you. David Torrance.
The question is for you, Mr. Barr. Just looking at the pictures and the size of these metal rods that are on there, how hard is that to fall over if these rods are inserted but the cement base is still gone round about?
I think the sort of straightforward answer is that we're looking at the maintenance within the cemetery on a fortnightly basis of grass cutting, for example. Most of that is now done by vehicular machinery. So there's quite a considerable amount of movement across that ground. The headstones are standing after that. So, you know, the design of the headstones is something that we've questioned. And I think that Andrew, you know, has touched on it. We had somebody just at the weekend who are now, after 12 years, are back at their monumental mason saying, this was never constructed properly. So I think to answer your question, yes, you know, how effective are these rods? How effective is the concrete that's used to secure them? And I think that falls back on the local authority in terms of trade and standards. So, you know, there are a number of issues. It's not just that the headstone is old. Maybe they were never, you know, properly put together in the first instance. So, you know, I hope that that answers your question, that yes, there are obviously other issues. But in terms of how easy it is, I would say it's not easy. I don't think that somebody is going to just walk by it or brush by it or fall into it and it fall over.
Now, it looks like you'd have to physically lift it off for it to come off. Mm-hmm. So that's what I was trying to get mm-hmm. to.
OK. Fergus, are there any questions you want to put to mind? No, fine. So, Paul Kane, would you like to comment on all we've been hearing this morning?
Thank you, Convener, and I'm very grateful to the committee for permitting me to attend this morning. I suppose my interest in this is that I met Mr. Barr, who is a constituent, and took some time to tour Hawkhead Cemetery with him. And I have seen firsthand the impact, I suppose, that the policy has had on many of the graves of people whose families are still living and visit that cemetery regularly. And I'm also very conscious of the work of groups like Friends of Groups who are caring for cemeteries, which are, of course, very important places for people who are bereaved. I'm also very aware of the challenges that I think, you know, Councillor Wood outlines in terms of my 10 years in a local authority as a local councillor. I think councils on the whole are very genuinely concerned about how we upkeep our burial grounds and our cemeteries and make sure that we can take pride in those places and that they are respectful and dignified places. But I think councils have also been very conscious of the health and safety implications that arose from the tragic incident at Craigdon Cemetery in Glasgow and that fatality. I do, however, feel that the policy reaction, though, has been to take a blanket approach rather than to take perhaps a more nuanced approach. And councils are very keen to comply with guidance that is issued by the government. I think what we've seen is a requirement really to make sure they stress test and monitor headstones and make good historic stones. But very often, I think the challenge for local authorities is one of finance. So it can be very difficult to maintain the levels and standards that we would expect to see in cemeteries without additional burdens being put on the local authority, given the context of the local government financial settlement. So, you know, I think I would recognise much of what the petitioners have said about that blanket approach of laying stones on the ground. It is not perhaps the best way to proceed, because then what you have is bereaved families coming to a grave and finding that their stone has been lowered, a lack of communication, a different interpretation of the guidance, I think, in different communities and different areas. And really, you know, I think that causes great distress. So it is clear to me there is an impact here in terms of cost. And I do think we have to look at local government and how they're appropriately funded to do this work and to do the more detailed work, perhaps, or the more considered piece of work that Mr. Torrance referred to in the previous exchange there. I did ask the Minister, Marie Todd, obviously from a public health angle, in a written question, if there were any intention to make a fund for local government to access to deliver a policy of what Mr. Barr described as a kind of rolling programme of making all those historic stones and those larger stones safe. Unfortunately, the response from the government was that there are no plans to do that, so that might be useful for the committee's information. I'm also concerned that it's not only an issue for local authorities, but we do have a number of private cemeteries in Scotland, particularly the Roman Catholic Church, the Jewish community and the Muslim community across Scotland maintain very often their own cemeteries. There may be a cost implication. Certainly St Conval Cemetery in Barrhead, one of, I think, of the largest Catholic cemeteries in the country, is in my region. So I think we do have to consider how the cost has to be borne not only by local authorities, but also by very often religion and religious groups. So I suppose to conclude my comments, I think if the government wants councils to meet their obligation, they need to be clearer about what the national standards should be and clearer that a blanket approach isn't working currently. And I think they have to provide funding in order for councils to maintain our cemeteries with the dignity and respect that we would all hope for. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. And thank you, gentlemen. I think that's been very helpful. Are colleagues content for us to reflect on this evidence and consider it at a future meeting of the committee? We are. So can I thank you both very much for taking the time to come and join us this morning. I think that's been very helpful in our consideration of the petition. Thank you, Paula Keane. And I'll suspend just briefly.
Can I ask that I get the photos back, if you don't mind? It's... Well, this is also a very emotional issue for families. It also reflects on Scotland as a nation insofar as, do we want to lose our heritage, our history and our culture by damaging such places? And we have what we call, I believe, the graveyard warriors from abroad. They come to find their families in Scotland. And I don't want that to be lost. I'm sure you don't either. So. Yeah.
OK, thank you very much. As I say, we now suspend.
Okay, so...
And welcome back. We are now considering our second petition, where we're going to be joined by witnesses remotely this morning. This is petition number 1950, which is ensure immunosuppressed people in Scotland can access the Evusheld antibody treatment. And this has been lodged by Alex Marshall. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to enable access via the National Health Service to Evusheld prophylactic treatment for people who have zero or weak response to the COVID-19 vaccines. Now, we previously considered this petition at our meeting on the 9th of November, where we agreed to write to various organisations and to invite the petitioner and representatives from the patient campaign group, Evusheld, for the UK to provide evidence to the committee. Members will have noted in our papers for today's meeting that the petitioner, Mr. Alex Marshall, has himself declined the opportunity to provide evidence or indeed to pursue the petition further, as he feels that the emergence of new COVID-19 variants has rendered the Evusheld treatment ineffective. I should also highlight that the committee have now received responses from the Scottish Medicines Consortium, Immunodeficiency UK, Blood Cancer UK and Kidney Research UK. Now, despite the unusual circumstances we find ourselves in and the fact that, you know, the pandemic has moved on, nonetheless, I think there are issues that the committee wishes to explore. And I'm pleased to welcome Mark Oakley and Nicola Brigden, both from Evusheld for the UK, remotely this morning. And so good morning to both of you. And we'll move straight to questions. If you can raise your hand or put in an R or the usual things, but the clerks are monitoring and they'll make sure that we know when you would like to come in and contribute. And I'm going to move straight to my colleague, David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to witnesses. How do witnesses respond to the assertion that Evusheld is not as effective against the Omicron variant of the virus?
And you have to try, I think maybe if you can seek to decide who's going to answer first.
I'll ask Mark first.
Okay. I mean, we are certainly in an ever-changing position with this virus. It is still, at the moment, in the UK, showing to be effective, not against all variants, but it is still giving some level of protection. We're kind of in the situation where somebody that's immunocompromised and hasn't had any protection, which I'm one of those people, if you told me I could take something that will give me 10% protection, I'll take that hand over fist. It's been suspended at the moment temporarily in the United States because of their variant mix, but they are looking to bring it back once that variant mix changes again. It's still in use in all the other European countries and the other 32 countries that are using it and still being used. And they are using it with a kind of a caveat on it that, you know, it isn't a magic bullet and that you still need to take other precautions with it. And I think anybody that is in this position of being immunocompromised isn't stupid enough to, you know, to take unnecessary risks, having had to shield for nigh on 3 years.
David Torrance?
Thank you, Convener. Is there further...
Do you want to bring in Nicola as well?
I don't know if Nicola's got anything to say on it.
Just to add to what Mark has said, most of the studies that have been carried out on the Evusheld against the new variants are in vitro, which are in the test tube. We know from the feedback from the immunologists and the people that were in contact abroad that the Evusheld works a lot different real world and in the real, the human body, and it seems to be a lot more effective in that manner. So, we're hearing that hospital admissions are down in other countries due to this.
Thank you for that. Is there any further real-world research being undertaken for Evusheld, which could be considered by NICE to help promote it?
I'm not sure. The honest answer is I'm not sure what studies are being taken abroad. Obviously, there has been a lot of studies when you look across globally. There's the veterans study in America. There's the one done in France by the Louis Pasteur Institute, and there's the CITES study in Israel. They have all been showing very, very good results against various variants.
Nicola, you got anything to add?
No, pretty much what Mark has just said. Yeah, I mean, there's new studies coming out all of the time, and as quick as we can get hold of them, we submit them to the government, you know, to give them the additional information.
And can I ask, I mean, given your own experience, and I have some direct experience as well, in what way did you find that the inability to access this particular treatment led to a different pathway through and out of the pandemic to others? I mean, clearly, people who are immunosuppressed, there were bigger concerns still resting with them, even as they saw everybody else acting more normally.
I mean, if I can come in there, I think to pick up on one of the phrases you used there, moving out of the pandemic. Got people in this situation are still very much in the pandemic.
Yeah.
People that haven't been able to, fortunate enough to be able to fund this drug for themselves, and that is the vast majority of people, are still living this pandemic every day. I was fortunate enough to be able to pay for the drug. I had it on the 1st of November. Up until that point, I was close to 1,000 days of shielding. It affects your family. It affects your work. And people are stuck in this situation still, and it's still ongoing. They're fearful. They have no financial support. It's having long-term mental effects on people. It's not a good situation, and they are still stuck in this situation. And here we are trying to use a system to evaluate drugs that is now outside of the pandemic, as opposed to what we've been using for the vaccines, etc., to try and get them in quickly. People are now going to be entering their fourth year of shielding come March. And further drugs are being developed by companies like AstraZeneca. And if we carry on down this route of using the NICE process, with the amount of time it's going to take, we're going to have people in this situation that are going to be going into 5 years of shielding if we use the same system that's been used for Evershield. That's nearly half a decade to leave these people and their families in that position.
Yeah, and I understand the point you make. As I say, I've some direct experience of this as well. But, I mean, you say that you did receive the treatment in November. But given the reservations, and this is the kind of contradiction in all of this that I just want to try and understand. I mean, given the reservations that have obviously been expressed from some, you know, jurisdictions about its effectiveness, does it give you the confidence to act in a more complete way as a result? I mean, so is it your view that, I think you said, even if it gives me 10% additional benefit, then that's 10% additional benefit I didn't have. Is it a sense that it may not be, you know, giving the full complete security that other vaccines might give other people, but nonetheless it advances the path towards giving confidence to those people who can't have those other vaccines but who could have this one? Is it essentially that? And on the back of that, have you felt more confident about acting in a way that is consistent with how you operated before?
Yes, absolutely. There's a big change when you have to step out that door for the first time, kind of, and start going into shops and things like that. And probably, talking to most people, they had it when they came out of, you know, the nationwide lockdowns, getting used to things. It does take a while to get used to it. No one, I think, in this position is foolish enough to. I'm certainly not, and other people that I've spoken to, put themselves in a position where they're going to put themselves at risk. But it does allow me to have more choice, to be able to choose to go into quieter shops at quieter times of day, be able to go and do more normal activities, like go into a restaurant when it's not so busy, and pick and choose and be careful. Choose what times I travel on public transport if I have to. It's a balance, and it has to be done with other mitigations in mind to protect yourself. You know, this isn't at the moment going to give me 100% protection, but no vaccine does either to anybody else.
Yeah. Nicola?
Just to add to that, really, to give you a little background, my husband, Scott, was diagnosed with mantle cell lymphoma at the age of 46 in 2021. It's quite a rare type of blood cancer. His prognosis isn't great. They've said probably 5 years, possibly. And, you know, to have to shield for the last 2 years, you know, he's had to fight through chemotherapy treatments, had a stem cell transplant, really fought to stay alive. And, you know, to have the impact of then having to shield and not be able to spend time with your loved ones, you know, the impact that it's had on our daughter, because she's had to stay away from us. She's studying away at university. You know, the mental impact on the families. You know, Scott's not been able to see his mum, give his mum a hug. You know, all of these, you know, everybody who's immunocompromised has similar situations. To have a life-changing diagnosis is hard enough, you know, without the then mental impact of having to deal with shielding. So, you know, I think that's one of the things that has gone unspoken about, you know, the impact on not just the people who are immunocompromised, but their families, and then the wider family beyond that as well. It's huge. You know, we speak to people every day, and, you know, they've fought so hard to stay alive, but they're at the point of giving up because, you know, everybody needs a purpose in life. And to not be able to go out and mix or even give their family a hug. You know, my husband had Evershield the same time as Mark on the 2nd of November. And, you know, we haven't gone out and gone mad. You know, the things that we have done is that Scott could have time with his family at Christmas Day. You know, he could hug our daughter. It's all of those simple things that most people take for granted, but mean so much, you know, and that's why we are here today, you know, speaking on behalf of so many people, you know, that feel so forgotten in all of this.
No, I'm grateful for that. And I think implicit in what you're saying is a sense among the community of those who are affected in this way that the, if you like, the lighthouse of public attention has maybe swung away, and people who are in this condition are kind of left to cope with it on their own without the same kind of attention that there was when this was a much more general and widespread affliction that was, you know, being felt by a much wider community across the country. So I do appreciate and understand that. Can I ask, I mean, and to move away from anything that is quite so personal in your own experience, but have you any knowledge of whether immunosuppressed people have disproportionately experienced morbidity as a result of the pandemic, or is it that the kind of exceptional care that they are having to take it makes it difficult to draw any kind of statistical conclusion or evidence in that regard? Either of you?
No, there is statistical evidence of that has been gathered. You know, through these years of the pandemic, that show that the risk to people in this situation is that much higher. I think I'm going off the top of my head, but I think we're in the realms of the late 20s to early 30% higher risk of morbidity and a bad outcome, which then, you know, puts people in a difficult position because it's a massive risk. Nobody wants to put themselves in that. And it's also the knock-on effect that it's then having on the health service. You know, the very people that you don't want going into hospital, taking up beds, taking up the resources for an extended period of time, that we could be protecting, and we're not. And that has a knock-on effect then for every other appointment that has to be cancelled for people with cancer, etc., because those resources are being taken up. We should be taking this opportunity. We should be doing everything we can to stop these people going into hospital, and we're not.
Indeed. And obviously, the, you know, various members of the committee have at different times served on the Health Committee here in the Scottish Parliament. We are kind of familiar with the commissioning process and the way that these things progress. And we've all lodged questions to ministers from time to time about the availability of product, and of course they've always deferred to NICE, the Scottish Medicines Consortium, and the processes that are at play. And I suppose their argument would be that were they to act by exception, then that would be at the cost of diverting resource away from treatments which have been through the commissioning process and which are being recommended to them. What would you say to them in the face of that conundrum, which they, as ministers, having to come to decisions in relation to the commissioning authorities, what would you say to them?
As I said before, you know, the people in this position are still living the pandemic. You know, we used much quicker systems for assessing these drugs and getting them into place during the pandemic than we have for Evusheld. You only have to look at the last vaccine that was approved by the government. It went through the MHRA and then was put into use within 2 months on very limited testing. And that's exactly right. That's what should be happening in that situation. It's needed and it needs to be assessed quickly. To put a drug like this, where so many people are affected by it, through a long, prolonged process, it's just wrong. It's just unfathomable, to be honest.
Okay.
And it's cruel.
So I understand. Essentially, you feel that this should be subject to the same emergency provisions that applied at the height of the pandemic in order to accelerate the consideration. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. And thank you so far for your comments, members of the panel. NICE have already taken some appraisals and some technological outlook to see what's been happening with this product. Are you aware of any other countries that are using Evusheld that have carried out similar appraisals or technological processes to that being carried out and undertaken by NICE itself, Mark?
It's being used in every G7 country. It's being used in 32 countries around the world. The European Medicines Authority sanctioned it. I understand from people who've spoken to that even Japan, which is notorious as one of the slowest countries to recommend and implement the use of drugs normally, you know, they have still assessed it and brought it into use. And yet here we are lagging behind. So it's, you know, worldwide, it's been used by a lot of countries.
Mm-hmm. I think that there was Ontario Health that had some issues with it. And I think they're aware, or they wouldn't recommend it routinely, I think, was one of the situations we had when it came to Ontario Health. And are you aware of any other countries that have withdrawn it? Or are having difficulty with it?
As I said earlier, certainly at the moment, the FDA in America have temporarily suspended its use. That's because of the makeup of the variants over there at present. However, they have made it clear that you know, the intention is, once that variant mix changes, their intention is to bring it back into use. They've told medical facilities not to get rid of their stocks of the drug so that it can be used again and rolled out.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. I mean, I mean, obviously, I acknowledge that there were many other countries that moved very quickly at a point when this drug could have been introduced and we didn't. I understand that NICE and the SMC were participants in a meeting that took place a fortnight ago and are now talking about final guidance being produced in April. So, I suspect there's not a lot that the committee is going to be able to do that's going to accelerate this process, but I understand everything you're saying as to why the petition is there and why you think it should. And it also brings home, I think, potentially lessons that can be learned, because who knows what situation we might face again. And it does seem that there was a process at a point. That process has been normalised back to existing practice, and therefore people are struggling. Carol Mockin, are you trying to catch my eye? No, particular. So I think that's been very helpful for us this morning, just in understanding the issues. Fergus Ewing,
thanks so much, Convener. Good morning to both Mark and Nicola. The information that has been provided to us suggests that there's around 650,000 people who are immunosuppressed in the UK, and around 80,000 in Scotland, and we're advised that that all of these people are at high risk of serious illness or death. So obviously we accept this is an extremely serious matter affecting a great number of people. Mark, you've mentioned a couple of times that people in this situation lacking access to Evusheld have been shielding. And do you have any hard evidence about how many or what proportion of the 80,000 or the 650,000 are actually shielding? Because, as you say, to shield for such a long time imposes an enormous strain, an unimaginable strain, actually, on any individuals who have to shield for that length of time, as I think Nicola has remarked upon earlier. But what I don't see, maybe I've missed it, but I don't see any evidence, if there is any, it may not be possible to obtain any, about how many of this group of people are actually still shielding and have been shielding now for several years. Mark first, and then Nicola.
It is a difficult one to quantify. I mean, even the figures of the number of people that are affected by this are from the NHS, and you know, they're not entirely clear on you know, their figures. I mean, certainly from our experience on our group, we've got about 3,000 members, and the vast majority of them are either shielding or living a very restricted life, being very, very careful where they go, what they do, not taking part in normal activities, which, you know, to be honest, you all sitting there, you don't think about it anymore, and the vast majority of the population doesn't think about it anymore. Going into a pub, going, sitting on a train, sitting on a bus. So, just judging by our group, it's still a high amount of people. And what you have to remember as well is, for every person that is immunocompromised, that is having to deal with this, in most cases there is at least one other family member that is also having to put their life on hold to some extent. We've had members that have lived separately from their family, continued times. I personally lived for nearly 9 months on and off away from my family, living in a summer house in the garden, at times when the risks were difficult. There are people that are not able to go to work. We've got a lot of people that, you know, at a time when nationally the workforce is missing people, we've got lots of examples of people that are having to make a choice between working or not. We were contacted by one school teacher. The school's removed the mitigations to protect her. She is left with a stark choice now. Does she carry on working and put herself at risk, or does she now go back and shield? And she's done the latter with no financial support. It's an ever-changing picture, and it's a very difficult one to quantify, but yes, there are certainly a high number of people that are having to live their lives in a really restricted way, and it is so difficult mentally for them and their family.
Well, I do appreciate everything you say there, and it's an extremely serious matter. Does Nicola want to add anything to that?
I think just picking up on what Mark said, you know, there's lots of things in the newspapers about the lost workforce. Where have all these skilled people gone? You know, the immunocompromised represents so many people. You know, my husband is an ROV pilot. You know, it crosses across the whole spectrum of professions. You know, people could go back to work, but they just can't because they're not safe. Yeah. I think the other important thing that we need to mention is it's not just Evusheld. You know, I think the protections that are in place for the immunocompromised are pretty lacking. You know, for people to access treatments if they catch COVID, you know, there's very limited access and types of drugs available now, with some of them potentially being withdrawn. You know, so that's another worry. We know from the reports on the group the way people actually can, you know, whether they can access the treatment if they catch COVID is you know, is hit and miss. So, you know, that adds another layer of worry to the people that we represent. So, you know, the whole system needs to be looked at.
Thank you.
Okay, and thank you both. I think for being with us this morning, I think obviously the committee very much appreciate the personal circumstance that both of you individually, and which is a variation on, unfortunately, a theme which is extraordinarily difficult. That's been very helpful for us. We will give some urgent consideration to what, if anything, we can do that might be useful and act accordingly. But thank you very much for giving evidence to us to allow us to consider the petition further this morning. Colleagues, are we content to consider the evidence we've heard later in private? We are. So thank you both very much, and I suspend again. We are moving on now to consideration of consideration of existing petitions, with petition number 1723, Essential Tremor Treatment in Scotland, lodged by Mary Ramsey. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to raise awareness of essential tremor and to support the introduction and use of a focused ultrasound scanner for treating people in Scotland who have this condition. And at our last consideration of the petition, the committee agreed to write to the Scottish Government and the National Specialist Services Committee on a number of outstanding issues. We have considered this petition on a number of occasions and we're quite engaged with it. In response to the committee, the Scottish Government has provided information about the role, membership and operation of the National Professional Patient and Public Reference Group. The National Services Division has now responded to the committee, setting out the current service provision and how it operates with the National Specialist Services Committee. The response states that at the time of writing, no formal application for a national MRG FUS service had been submitted by NHS Tayside. And we're joined this morning by Rhoda Grant in relation to this petition. Rhoda, is there anything you would like to say to the committee before we consider the various representations we've recently received?
Yes, thank you, Convener, and I appreciate you allowing me to speak again on this petition, because it's really disappointing that since Mary Ramsay started her campaign, there's still no nationally recognised treatment centre for focused ultrasound in Scotland. And in England, there are already two centres offering treatment on the NHS. And we've got the facilities here that happened since Mary started her petition. We have the facilities in Dundee, but we appear to have made little progress in having that universally available on the NHS here. Scottish patients are being sent south and treated in England, and that is difficult for them with the travel involved. It adds to their distress and their time away from home, but it also adds a cost to the Scottish NHS. And some health boards are sending their patients to Dundee because they know the facility is there, but it would be much better if all health boards had a clear pathway to send people to Dundee. I understand that there is now an application has been submitted to the National Services Division, which has obviously crossed with their information to you. And that's obviously from NHS Tayside. And they're looking to have this treatment nationally adopted. But I'm not clear when that will be considered and what the time frame for that is. So I wonder if that is something the committee would raise with both the National Services Division and the Scottish Government, because it would be really good if we could pin them down as to when it will be considered and what stages take place, a likely time frame for them to reach a decision. It also, I think, while we're doing that, maybe just useful to try and find out why the treatment has been assessed as useful and available in the rest of the UK, but not here in Scotland. Mary Ramsay also asked me to say that she stands ready to give evidence to the committee. She really believes that the committee should hear directly from people who are suffering from and affected by essential tremor, and the impact that that has on their lives. And just, I suppose, in closing, Convener, we're hoping to have a drop-in on the 16th of March, 1 p.m, Committee Room 3. That's a plug. But I would very much like to extend an invitation to committee members, because Mary will be there, along with other campaigners, people who have been treated for essential tremor by both treatments available and clinicians as well. So it should be really informative, and you'd be very welcome to be there.
Well, I mean, given that this is very much in connection with a petition that's open and is under consideration, I'd be perfectly in order for the Petitions Committee to actively promote the fact that that will be there, and hopefully, certainly, there'll be an opportunity then for committee members to drop in to meet Mary Ramsay and to, in the first instance, engage with that drop-in event, which I think would be a productive thing to do. In your evidence to us this morning, Rhoda, I think you've actually taken us slightly further forward, and did I understand you to say that you think that the application has now been lodged by NHS, you assume by NHS Tayside?
Yes.
So I think we might want to confirm that with NHS Tayside, the committee agreed. But at the same time, I think you then think that having happened, the submissions we've had previously have all been about, you know, how that might happen. But that having happened, I think we might want to know from all those who have an active part in the resolution of this what the timescale and likely progress of this application might now be. Are we agreed with that too?
I'm just wondering, Convener, if we could ask if there's any barriers to it as well that's going to stop it progressing.
Yes.
Because I'm extremely disappointed that the progress this has made, actually.
Yeah, I think we all are, and I think that's why the petition has stayed open. It just seems to have been quite a curious and bureaucratic, almost, obfuscation, given the opportunity and the benefit that there would clearly be to be patients here in Scotland. And I think we, you know, heard how the alternative really has been so disappointing historically. So I think we want to try and clarify those points. So in many respects, thank you, Rhoda, because I think that's taken forward the committee's understanding of where things are at the moment. Do any other colleagues have anything they would like to say? So we'll keep the petition open and we'll write, I think, to the various organisations, the Scottish Government, after just confirming with NHS Tayside that that application has now been submitted. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We move to petition number 1871, the full review of mental health services. This has been lodged by Karen McEwen. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to carry out a full review of mental health services in Scotland to include the referral process, crisis support, risk assessment, safe plans, integrated services, working together, first response support and the support available to families affected by suicide. And members, of course, will recall that we held evidence sessions on this petition with the petitioner herself, Karen, and the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care at the end of last year. And I'd like to thank Karen again for coming forward at the time to give evidence to the committee on the difficult subject. And at the session with Karen, we heard about the importance of evaluating and reviewing how Scotland's mental health services perform and the need for dedicated facilities for people waiting to get mental health support. Then with the Cabinet Secretary, we discussed the broader policy context with a focus on the previous and current suicide prevention action plans. And the committee also explored waiting times and new pilot services. They were both, I think, very enlightening and productive evidence sessions. And in the light of that and the submissions we received and the reflections we've had, and having thought about the evidence, are there suggestions members would like to come forward with? Alexander Stewart?
I agree, Convener. I think that the sessions we had were very informative. But I think it's now time to follow up on some of that information that we're looking to provide. And I would suggest that that we seek details of the 2018 Suicide Prevention Action Plan evaluation, because I think that's important that we try and establish where we are. And when the outcomes framework for the new Suicide Prevention Action Plan will be published are also very important. And also for specific information on mental health assessment units, including locations, funding, patient uptake, and any expansion. That was something that we really felt very strong, and I still think there are room for that to be given more detail and more expansion on, and an update on whether the Scottish Government will expand and expect them, and when we're going to publish the Scottish Mental Health Law Reform before summer recess would be also, I think, very useful. So these are some recommendations that I would suggest that we look at for this one, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. And, you know, it occurs to me in relation to the information about the mental health assessment units that what is available in the public domain it seems to be extraordinarily vague, because it's my understanding that there are now some 13 of these units established, but there doesn't seem to be any public record of where they are or how they operate or any more general information regarding them at all. And that all just seems, you know, to be kind of lacking a sort of transparency, which I think we might hope and expect as part of our proper consideration of the actions that are being taken. So, I think that point that you made, Mr. Stewart, in particular, is one that we want to emphasise. Carol Malkin.
I would just like to come in and be very supportive of that point. I think that a lot of constituents contact us on this issue, very distressed, and there is a lack of urgency around providing that information which might give people direction and comfort. So I think it's important that we're quite strong that we have had delay in this area for far too long. Thank you.
Yep. Colleagues, are we otherwise agreed? Well, just to say to Karen, thank you again. We're keeping the petition open and we'll be pursuing some of the issues arising out of the evidence sessions that we last heard, both with Karen and with the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing. Brings us to petition number 1885, make offering community shared ownership mandatory for all wind farm development planning proposals. This has been lodged by Karen Murphy and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to make community shared ownership a mandatory requirement to be offered as part of all planning proposals for wind farm development. Now, following the committee's evidence session with the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth, we followed up with the Minister and the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport on a number of points. And the Minister has stated in his recent submission that local place plans have no role in encouraging shared community ownership through planning systems due to existing restrictions. However, planning authorities may be able to direct renewable energy businesses towards information about any known community aspirations for CSO. Now, the Minister has stated again that the Scottish Government has no powers to mandate community share ownership and highlights existing support for communities considering CSO opportunities. Now, the petitioner's recent submission reiterates our suggestion that CSO could be mandated through raising a new tax, which would require all developers who don't own the lands to make a CSO offer in line with the good practice principles. An upcoming review of good practice principles has been highlighted by the Cabinet Secretary, stating that a consultation on the draft guidance is planned for this year. The Scottish Government intends to build on any equivalent relevant lessons from the petition into future updates to the equivalent guidance for onshore renewables. And in the light of that potential, there seems to be some progress potentially underway. And I wonder if colleagues have any suggestions or comments on what we might do next. Fergus Ewing?
A few observations. We last considered this on the 29th of June, and since then, the petitioner in August made a further submission, and the first point I wanted to make was that in that submission, the petitioner argues in some detail that the Scottish Government does have power to mandate community ownership. Now, I am not able to assess whether that view is correct or incorrect, but I think out of fairness, and given that the petitioner has set out in quite a lot of detail in his submission, we should at the very least put that to the Scottish Government, in other words, to ask if the Scottish Government agree with the petitioner's view, and if not, why not? And secondly, in the letter that we sent after the last evidence session, following suggestions, Convener, which I think I made in the course of my remarks, I did ask whether the Scottish National Investment Bank, whose existence, after all, is to serve the purpose of promoting green schemes, whether they might produce a tranche of funding that could be made available for communities. Now, in the response we've got from the Minister, he says that we are also working with SNIB to assess the pipeline of shared ownership. That's really not what I asked. What I asked was, will they provide a tranche of money? Because they're a bank, they're supposed to operate in commercial terms. If they grant a loan to communities, there's a guaranteed income stream, and thereby it is a lendable proposition based on a financial flow of income which can be used to repay the loan. So I wonder, Convener, if in light of that, it may be possible to press the Minister, both with regard to the petitioner's request that perhaps the Scottish Parliament does have legal power to do this, and perhaps he's wrong, perhaps he's right, but I think we owe it to the petitioner to follow that point up. And secondly, write directly to SNIP to ask if they plan to make a tranche of money available, and if not, why not? Because this seems to be an ideal opportunity. And just lastly, Convener, I would like to press the Minister a bit further, because I was many moons ago in his position as the Energy Minister, and proactively worked with banks such as the Co-op Bank, Close Brothers and Triodos in order to work with them to ensure that they provided 90 or 95% of the loan funding, and the Scottish Government, through a renewables fund, provided the remaining 5 or 10%. And it worked extremely well. And the problem is, and I'm sorry to go on at some length, but I think this is really, really an important opportunity for communities in Scotland, in rural Scotland in particular. We need to get on with this, and there's a huge desire to do it. It's far better to own a stake than to get a cheque, the community benefit, so-called. And those communities that have established community ownership have reaped a huge benefit, which enables them to help people in their community who are disadvantaged, or help with kids' education, or whatever they so choose. So I hope that members feel that those suggestions are worth pursuing rather than close the petition today. My apologies to those members.
I think Mr. Torrance has been gazumped. I thank you very much for that, Mr. Ewing. I think both those points, impassionately and coherently argued, are ones that the committee should take forward. So I think we will return to the Minister to clarify, using, I think, the context of the submission we've received, which appears to be quite detailed in respect of the contradictory view of the petitioner. And secondly, I think, as Mr. Ewing suggests, we should more directly, and I think the "are you" and "if not, why not" question is a very good question for us to put, because obviously that would facilitate the very kind of progress that the petitioner is looking for and, as Mr. Ewing says, is ought to be within reach and achievable.
I'm always looking for a chance to agree.
In some ways, if not in others. But are we agreed then with the suggestions from our colleague?
Agreed.
We are agreed. Thank you very much. That brings us to petition number 1907, which is the funding early learning and childcare for all two-year-olds in Scotland. And this is still a continuing petition, yeah? Yes. Lodged by Claire Beats. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide funded early learning and childcare for all two-year-olds, removing eligibility criteria to access for access to services. Now, we last considered this position on the 26th of October, and at that point we agreed to write to the Scottish Government seeking information on the anticipated timescales for expanding early learning and childcare provision to 1 and 2 year olds. The committee has now received a response from the Scottish Government which highlights the publication of the Best Start Strategic Early Learning and School Age Childcare Plan 2022 to 2026. The plan sets out this government's priorities over the current parliament, indicates that phase one of their commitment to develop a new offer of early learning and childcare for 1 and 2 year olds is underway, and that the findings from this first phase of this programme can be expected from 23 to 24 onwards. So in the light of the Scottish Government sort of setting out that timetable, which does appear to respond to the arguments within the petition. David Torrance.
Thank you very much, Convener. Concerning the response from the Government, I would like to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government has committed to expand early learning and childcare to 1 and 2 year olds with the Best Start Strategic Early Learning and School-Aged Children Plan 2022 to 2026. The plan stating that from 23 to 24 onwards, the Scottish Government will start to develop, trial and evaluate models for provision.
Okay. Suggestion from Mr. Torrance. Are colleagues in the committee content?
Confirm.
Do we do so? We thank the petitioner very much for their petition, and we hope that the action of the Scottish Government now progresses. And of course, as we've said in the past, in the event that they feel there has been a shortcoming in the commitment that has been given, then they are able to come back to us with a fresh petition in due course. That brings us to petition number 1920 to introduce more thorough follow-up care for women with diabetes, lodged by Laura Hastings, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide more thorough follow-up for care for women with diabetes. And we previously considered this at our meeting on the 23rd of February 2022. It's quite fresh in my mind. I'm surprised it's long ago as this. So we would like to put on record our apologies to the petitioner for not returning to the issue before now. At that meeting, the committee agreed to write to the Scottish Diabetes Group and relevant stakeholders to ask whether they are satisfied with the measures that the Scottish Government have taken in women's health and diabetic health. Now, the committee has now received a response from the chair of the Scottish Diabetes Group. The response highlights the National Diabetes Dataset SCI Diabetes, which has been used to inform the work of the NHS Research Scotland Diabetes Epidemiology Group on the impact of inequalities in diabetes care. The response recognises the significant impact menstruation and menopause can have on diabetes control, as well as the increased risk of cardiovascular disease for women with diabetes. The chair of the SDG also indicates that the Women's Health Plan will be discussed at SDG and National Diabetes MCN meetings to ensure widespread awareness of this policy. The committee also wrote to Diabetes Scotland to seek their view on the issues raised by the petition, but unfortunately, despite our best efforts, our response has not been forthcoming. So in view of the response we've received from the Scottish Diabetes Group and the Scottish Government, are there any suggestions colleagues would like to make? David Torrance?
Thank you, Convener. Considering the information we have received back, I think Petitions actually achieved what it's actually meant to try and do. So I would like to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Diabetes Group are continuing to develop a national diabetes data set, CSI Diabetes, and use this data to inform ongoing commitments related to the Diabetes Improvement Plan 2021, and have discussed with the Women's Health Plan, SDG, and the National Diabetes Meetings to ensure widespread awareness of this policy and its impact on the Diabetes Improvement Plan 2021.
Thank you. Do any colleagues have any comments? Are they content to proceed? So again, we thank the petitioner for the petition, and again say that in the event they feel that the petition, that the actions that have now been promised don't materialise, then they are able to return at a later date. That brings us to petition. In fact, that's the last of our continuing petitions. We now move to new petitions. And as I normally caveat before we move to new petitions, just to say that before the committee considers a new petition, we do send the petition and a request of the Scottish Government an initial view in relation to the objectives of the petition, simply in order that we don't spend the first meeting agreeing to do that, which would only delay our progress and consideration. So the first petition that we consider this morning is petition number 1968 to restrict perpetrators of domestic abuse from using family court proceedings to continue tormenting their victims. This first petition has been lodged by Angela Evans, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review existing legislation on family law and seek to stop perpetrators of domestic abuse causing further abuse and distress to partners and children by removing their ability to apply for contact orders under Section 11 of the Children's Scotland Act 2020. Now, Angela tells us that mothers and their children are being let down by the family court system, which has granted contact orders to perpetrators of domestic abuse. This, in Angela's view, forces victims of abuse, which can include the child or children, to spend time with someone who has abused them, potentially putting them at further risk. As we do with all new petitions, the committee, as I said a moment ago, has sought an initial response from the Scottish Government, which states that there is no place for domestic abuse in Scotland, but suggests that removing the ability of perpetrators of domestic abuse to apply for contact orders might raise questions about just access to justice. I should note that the Scottish Government response and the briefing we have received from both Spice both highlight that applications to court for contact orders are made under Section 11 of the Children's Scotland Act 1995 rather than the 2020 Act referred to in the petition. The Scottish Government response also notes that changes to the law in Section 11 of the 1995 Act have recognised the impact of domestic abuse. This includes provisions contained in the 2020 Act, which have yet to be implemented. These provisions relate to matters such as the appointment of a child welfare reporter to gather the views of the child and report on the child's best interests, and the use of special measures to help protect vulnerable witnesses and parties in the consideration of family cases. Now, information contained at the Spice briefing suggests that it may be 2024 before these provisions are implemented in the new systems, or the new systems of regulation become operational, which hardly seems ideal. Do members have any comments, suggestions for action? Alexander Stewart.
Well, Convener, I'm perplexed by this in some ways, because I appreciate what the Scottish Government are saying, what they are attempting to do. But there is still, in my view, areas of responsibility that maybe require some clarity. And the time lapse in this as well is I think, distressful. And I note what the petitioner says about being let down and the complexities of something of this nature. But there is no doubt that there is a bit of exposure here to individuals by potential abusers in this whole process. So I would seek some clarity. I would like to see more information from organisations that may well be able to give us a little bit more advice and support. And I would suggest that the Law Society of Scotland should be written to. And the Scottish Women's Aid, I think, have a role in this. Shared Parenting Scotland and also the Children and Young People's Commissioner, I do think, have a role within where we are. I acknowledge, Convener, what the Government are saying, and in due course, things may improve. But at the present time, I don't see that being the reality.
Thank you. I mean, I've got to say, it was judged necessary for the protection of families in a situation of domestic abuse to introduce regulations in as a consequence of the 2020 Act, which aren't going to be implemented until 2024. I know, let me anticipate that I'm going to be told that the pandemic means that various work on various things was delayed. But I mean, to be sitting here being told that it's expected that they might happen in 2020 all sounds a bit vague and woolly to me. And I really would like to go back to the Scottish Government for an explanation as to why we have undertaken, in addition to the recommendation of Alan Zander Stewart, I'd like to propose we go back to the Scottish Government to ask why on earth, this delay in something of an issue of protection that the Parliament regarded as being necessary, such that we embodied it in legislation, is going to take until 2024 and an unspecified date in 2024 at that. I think, you know, that all seems to me just a lack of urgency. The pandemic is now behind us, in the sense that I don't think it's imposing a burden on government that it can't pursue the implementation of provisions under its own legislation. And I think that, the distress this will be causing really ought to be given a greater degree of urgency than this would suggest it has been. Are colleagues content that we proceed on that basis? Anybody else want to comment? Carol Morgan?
Yeah, I just want to be very supportive of the comments, particularly, you know, some feedback from organisations such as Women's Aid, because that might give some weight to the fact that, as you say, waiting 4 years for such urgent legislation just does not seem in any way sensible. So no, very supportive. No.
Well, it's not even like we've got the legislation, it's we're not actually implementing it, which is the extraordinary thing in some ways to me. So we agreed that we'll proceed on that basis. Thank you. It brings us to our next new petition. It's petition number 1979, to establish an independent inquiry and an independent national whistleblowing officer to investigate concerns about the alleged mishandling of child safeguarding inquiries by public bodies. This new petition has been lodged by Neil McLennan, Christine Scott, Alison Dickey and Bill Cook. And I understand and see that some of the petitioners have joined us in the public gallery to observe our initial consideration of the committee today. And insofar as they are all here, we welcome them to our proceedings. Now, the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to launch an independent inquiry to examine concerns that allegations about child protection, child abuse, safeguarding and children's rights have been mishandled by public bodies, including local authorities and the General Teaching Council Scotland, the GTCS, gaps in the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, and establish an independent national whistleblowing officer for education and children's services in Scotland to handle these inquiries in future. The petitioners tell us that they have supported whistleblowers in raising historic and current allegations about child protection, child abuse, safeguarding and children's rights. And while acknowledging the work of the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, the petitioners believe a separate and wider inquiry into safeguarding is required. In responding to the asks of the petition, the Minister for Children and Young People states that learnings from the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, the independent inquiry into child sex abuse in England, and actions such as the implementation of the revised National Child Protection Guidance mean that the Scottish Government do not consider there is a need to extend the scope of the SCAI or establish a separate inquiry to explore concerns that allegations about safeguarding have been mishandled by public bodies. Now, while the petitioners have welcomed comments about improving systems as a result of the inquiries into cases of non-recent child abuse, they have restated the call for a distinct inquiry into wider allegations and whistleblower concerns about unresolved child protection issues which relate to organised criminal child exploitation and trafficking. The petitioners also highlight in their response that National Child Protection Guidance is non-statutory and consider the guidance to be confusing, complex and somewhat contradictory. Now, the committee have also received a number of written submissions in support of the petition, many of which share details of their family's evidence, and colleagues will recall our consideration of the eligibility and criteria around some of the submissions that we've received, which we have previously considered. But many of which share details of their family's experience in pursuing child protection and safeguarding concerns and the difficulties encountered in trying to resolve these concerns with a variety of public bodies. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? I certainly am inclined to just follow the Scottish Government's initial response of saying that they don't see any further merit in any of this. So, David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Probably like most of the committee, I'd like to keep this petition open and gather some more evidence on it, so what's been asked for within the petition. So I'd like to write to several stakeholders, including the Children and Young People's Commissioner Scotland, COSLA, EIS and the Unison Trade Unions, the General Teaching Council for Scotland and Scottish Social Services Council.
Alexander Stewart.
Convener, I would certainly agree with all of that. I think that the petitioners have found, in my opinion, maybe there is a gap here, and there is no doubt that it is confusing and complex, and that the necessity for a whistleblower in this process may well be what is required. So I think by getting some information from these organisations, we will get a better flavour as to how that is working, because there are sets and circumstances and guidelines there already. But I do, as I said already, I think there's a gap in the process here, and that might help us understand, and also to ask government as to how they plan to progress this if that gap is perceived to be very much real and focused on where we want to take it.
Fergus Ewing.
Yes, I agree with all the comments thus far. I don't think the Scottish Government's reply is adequate or sufficient by any means. I note that several MSPs from all parties have raised individual cases, which I think is an indication that this matter is not sufficiently well dealt with at the moment. I would just make a plea, really, to those present here today and who may have an interest in this, which is that without further evidence from petitioners or others who have specific concerns, it's a little bit difficult for us to perhaps move toward and identify the solutions, although suggestions have been made, which I think are very worthy of serious consideration. So I'd make a plea for further information to be provided. And I think in many cases, of course, information about particular cases would require to be kept confidential. And the last point I would make is that people in this situation probably feel pretty in a kind of David and Goliath situation, where they're David and the public authorities are Goliath, and feel very kind of lonely, isolated, unempowered, hopeless, powerless to act, and very often that the public authorities are not really listening. And that's the experience I've had over many years as an MSP, and therefore I think we really need to give David that sling in order to be able to take on Goliath.
Thank you. Are we agreed? I think it might also be that we would draw Mr. Ewing's comments there to the attention of colleagues in the Scottish Parliament who have raised these issues, to see whether there's anything more they might be able to offer the committee by way of testimony or consideration. That would be very helpful, I think. So I think we are all agreed that we are going to keep this petition open, that there are some serious issues underpinning it that need to be properly examined and pursued. And we've outlined a number of open work streams that we'll pursue ahead of our next consideration of the petition. Are colleagues content with that at this stage? We are. Thank you very much. I hope the petitioners are. I mean, it may not have felt like a long time of consideration, but I hope you see we'll take practical steps forward. So thank you very much. We move to petition number 1981 to ensure that perpetrators of domestic abuse who have been excluded from the matrimonial home cannot force the sale of the property. Our next petition is one that's been lodged by Carolyn Gourley, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to strengthen legislation to stop perpetrators of domestic abuse who have been excluded from the matrimonial home by a court order being able to cause further trauma and distress to their victims by trying to force the sale of the property. Caroline highlights the potential loophole in existing legislation that enables perpetrators of domestic abuse to contact their victims via a third party to force the sale of a property. In responding to the petition, the Scottish Government note that Section 4 of the Matrimonial Homes Family Protection Scotland Act 1981 provides protection to a spouse or to children who are at risk of physical or mental injury because of the other spouse's conduct. This is achieved by applying to the court for an exclusion order. The Scottish Government also note that where a court action has been raised in relation to the division and sale of the matrimonial home, the 1981 Act also includes provisions for the court to refuse to grant the decree or postpone doing so for a period it considers reasonable. The court may also grant the decree subject to conditions. Now, while the Scottish Government have indicated that they have no plans at present to reform the 1981 Act or equivalent provisions for civil partners, it is expected that phase two of the Scottish Law Commission's review of aspects of family law will focus on civil remedies for domestic abuse. And following the Scottish Government's response, we have also received a submission from the petitioner, which highlights that being contacted via a third party such as a solicitor can be a distressing and traumatic experience for victims, even where exclusion orders and interdicts are in place. It is for this reason that Caroline believes individuals subject to interdict and exclusion orders should not be permitted to contact their victim directly or indirectly while the court order remains in place. So this is a kind of sort of technical legal thing, and any suggestions we would like
I
to
wonder if the committee convener could write first to the Scottish Law Commission to ask whether the issues raised in the petition will be looked at phase two in the review and aspects of family law.
Any other suggestions, colleagues?
I think also it would be useful also to gather more information from some of the organisations we've talked about in the past. You know, I think the Law Society of Scotland does have a role in this, and so does the Family Law Association and Shared Parenting Scotland. I think their views and opinions would be useful in adding to what Mr Torrance has already talked about and going to the Law Commission for Scotland itself.
I mean, I do notice the Scottish Government in their response say if a couple married or cohabiting own a home together, both must agree to a sale. Otherwise, the party who wants to sell the property will need to raise a court action seeking an order for division and sale under Section 19 of the Act. Where a spouse has raised an action of division and sale involving the matrimonial home, the court may refuse to grant the decree or postpone doing so for a period it considers reasonable, or may grant the decree subject to conditions. You're a lawyer, Mr. Hughes. Are you able to sort of just shed any nuance into all of this?
I hesitate to opine because I haven't really given it sufficient consideration, but I just make a couple of remarks that in not every case is title held in joint names. In many cases, the title may be in the sole name of the excluded person, usually, almost always, the man, the husband or partner. So where the title is solely in the name of the person who's been excluded, then the argument, which has rightly been put forward, I think, by the Scottish Government, that an action division and sale would be required, doesn't apply, because that only applies where there's joint title, and that would normally be the case. But it's not infrequent that title is solely in the name of the husband. It could be that the property was acquired by him before the marriage, or it could be that it was just taken in his name, perhaps as the wage earner and so on. So I do think there is a loophole here. And if it is right to exclude a male for his violent behaviour, and an exclusion order will not readily be granted unless there is some real substance and evidence, then I don't see how it can be right and permissible for that person who, through his own actions, has had an exclusion order because probably of his violence towards his wife. I don't see it's right that he should then be allowed to sell the property from underneath her feet. It just seems to be plainly wrong. And therefore, I do think that, you know, in the interests of female rights and justice, that this loophole should be closed. And that's just an off-the-cuff and personal view, convener. But
that's very helpful.
But I hope that helps.
No, it does. I think it does help. So I think that we are agreed that we will write to the various organisations in the first instance, and I just think that wee synopsis is quite good context for us as we consider the issue as we proceed. Are we content to proceed on that basis? We are. That brings us to petition number 1982 to review funding arrangements for higher education to help ensure more funded places are available for Scottish ballet dancers at the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland. And this has been lodged by who's it been lodged by? Gary McKay. Sorry, it's just not my note in front of me. Apologies, Mr. McKay, but it'll be by Gary McKay. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the funding provided to the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland and to help enable more places to be made available to Scottish students pursuing ballet at this level. The Spice briefing states that higher education institutions are autonomous bodies, though they receive significant funding from the Scottish Government. It notes that the Scottish Government does not direct how many funded places individual universities make available, and that it is unable to intervene in internal institutional matters. In 2021, funding was provided to the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland, and it provided 30 places for Scottish domiciled students studying dance. The response from the Scottish Government reiterates those technical points and notes that universities are able to offer as many places to international students as they wish. Now, we've received a submission from the petitioner which highlights issues of availability for Scottish dancers to continue in further ballet education. He shares his view that the current setup provides a means for increased business turnover and focus on financial interests. The petitioner raises concerns about the financial burden faced by students who may know of no other choice but to study outside of Scotland as a result of many limited places at the Royal Conservatoire. Do members have any comments? Because, I mean, I appreciate the general point that the petitioner is making about international students absorbing much of the availability for places. Mr. Ewing?
Yes, I should say that I did have a constituent's case of their daughter who was an accomplished dancer and sought to obtain a place at the Royal Conservatoire. And their experience was very much in line with that described by the petitioner. Namely, although she appeared to have the credentials, the skill to earn a place there, it was found that the places were given mostly to pupils, to candidates from elsewhere in the UK. I think I did see evidence of this, although it's a few years back, convener, evidence that suggested that the Royal Conservatoire has a very close link with one particular establishment in England, many candidates from which gained places in the Conservatoire. Now, I'm not in a position to make any judgment other than to say that it did seem to me from correspondence that I had with the Royal Conservatoire at the time that there is a serious problem and that Scottish candidates are not getting into the Royal Conservatoire. That's how it appeared to me, convener. I did get a reply from the management at the Royal Conservatoire. I have to say, my recollection was that it was really quite dismissive of these concerns. That, at the time, disappointed me. I'm not sure that at the end of the day there is any locus for us to act or how we could act, but surely it is wrong in principle that qualified young people in Scotland who wish to pursue a career in this specialist area of ballet and who, in every single case, have devoted their whole childhood and adolescence to doing so, spending hundreds, if not thousands of hours, trying to get into a very small, limited pool of places, should at least have the chance to get into the ballet school in their own country. So because of that experience, convener, which I admit is anecdotal, I do think we should pursue this with the Royal Conservatoire Scottish Ballet and ask them to provide evidence of the number of applicants from Scotland and the number of applicants from Scotland who have been accepted over a period of, say, the last 10 years, and where the candidates who have been accepted, the other candidates who have been accepted, from whence they have come. Because I think this is perhaps a limited case here. There's not many people involved, but I was aware that this caused this particular family real heartache and disappointment with the system as it operates in Scotland.
Yes, I mean, I suspect it, in some ways it's the tip of the iceberg, because I think the current funding model, probably in particularly specialised disciplines, is leading to this potential situation. I think I would be quite interested, in as constructive a way as possible, to open a discussion with the Royal Conservatoire as to the challenges that they think that they face, and what their application and award of places model really is, and to the extent to which they want or are prepared to be candid about the allocation of places based on the fact that it does create an additional financial revenue stream, and the extent to which they themselves accept or acknowledge the difficulties that might be placing on the ability of Scottish domiciled residents to access courses at the Royal Conservatoire. I mean, ultimately, there is a reputational issue for the Royal Conservatoire, and I think that, you know, they enjoy a tremendous amount of public goodwill. I know that to be so. But, you know, that is, I think, very much because it is the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland, and people imagine that those of talent here in Scotland will have a fair and equal opportunity to access the courses in respect of the disciplines in which they specialise. Now, I accept that that argument could be made in relation to access to other further education institutions as well, and that's as may be, but we are considering a petition in relation to this particular consideration, and I think that it would be reasonable for us to, at least using the official hat of the Scottish Parliament, to seek to get slightly more information from them. David Torrance?
Can I ask, when we're contacting them, that I do believe in the evidence that you read out there, that there's 30 places funded, that they are fulfilling all these 30 places for Scottish students?
Yep, I think it would be interesting to have that information. Okay. And that brings us to the end of the... Our guests have just arrived. So that brings us to the end of the public session of this part of our proceedings, and we will next be meeting on the 22nd of February. And we now move into private session to consider item 5.